one of those passages where we get to the heart of what was important to the Apostle Paul. That's right. Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort in love, any sharing in the Spirit, any sympathy, complete my joy by thinking the same way, having the same love, being united and agreeing with each other. Don't do anything for selfish purposes, but with humility think of others as being better than yourselves. Instead, let each person watch out for their own good. Watch out for what is better for others. Adopt the attitude that was in Christ Jesus. Though he was in the form of God, did not consider being equal with God something to exploit, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a slave and by becoming like human beings. When he found himself in the form of a human, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalted him and gave him a name above all names, so that at the name of Jesus, everyone in heaven, on earth, and under the earth might bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved ones, just as you always obey me, not just when I am present, but now even more while I am away, carry out your own salvation with fear and trembling. God is the one who enables you to both to want and to actually live out his good purpose. This is the word of God to the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
In this portion of Paul's letter to the church in Philippi, we see articulated for us in the 21st century what is the point of all of this. A lot has been made over the last few years in the United Methodist Church and in our own country about the need for unity. We read a passage like this from Paul, and it says, see, don't disagree. Agree on everything. Unity above all else. And that is not what Paul is implying or claiming for the church. We are to be of one mind in Christ. Everything else is up for debate and discussion and human frailty. But when it comes to Christ, we are followers of Him, not of a denomination or a flag or a particular version of Scripture. So, he goes into the beginning of this passage that I just read, talking about, let's cut to the chase, to the church. He says to us and to them, remember why this is important. Remember why you became a Christian in the first place. Remember that the mind that was in Christ is in you. And if that is true, then you must act on it. You must reflect God's love, not just talk about it. And then Paul moves into this hymn of Christ, one of the earliest hymns in the Bible, or at least in the New Testament. It's called a Christ, a hymn of Christ, or a Christological pronouncement. That means Jesus talks. That's what we're doing. That's what the choir does. That's what they do in Sunday school. That's what we do in the study groups. That's what we do at the clothes closet. For the pantry partners. That's what you do at the senior center. Is you talk about Christ as you live in Him. Oh, now it makes sense. All the meetings you've gone to, now they start to make sense. Oh, what are we calling them? Stewardship, thank you. I knew it had some technical term. The stewardship campaign. It's not just about money, although money is important. Money is a means to an end. But we do that as a reflection of what God is doing in us, not what we can do with each other. So, if you have a Bible in front of you, wink, wink. Everyone has a Bible in front of you. That's where it was. Leave it to the choir director. Tell me where my Bible is. In verse, with small print. 5. Paul talks to us about Christ. We are Christians. We are to be little Christ. So if you're going to follow him, you need to know who he is and where you are in relationship with that Jesus. Though he was in the form of God, he did not consider being equal with God something to exploit. Paul is laying out for the church, Jesus is God. That was a bold statement for someone raised in the tradition of the Pharisees. Because we claim to have one God. And yet Paul is saying to the church, Jesus is God. Do you get how radical that is? This is the religion that you're part of. This isn't some mamby-pamby, cotton-candy kind of religion. This is a religion that makes bold, in-your-face claims. Isn't that cool? I mean, we're part of something that's on a big scale. It's cosmic, man. Rock on. So Jesus is God. God is in Jesus. And guess what? Jesus is in us. So what does that mean about us? God is in us. That'll change you when you're brushing your teeth tomorrow morning. You're looking in the mirror, and if you don't have a little woo-hoo, go back to bed. But he emptied himself by taking the form of a slave and becoming like human beings. When he found himself in the form of a human. This is the second great claim of the church. The second powerful, bigger than life claim about Jesus. And the second claim that I want each of us to be able to make when we go to Frontier Cafe, or we go to work tomorrow, or we go to the senior center. one of us. Jesus is. Jesus is one of us. That's huge. No other religion can make that claim, that Jesus is human, that God ever had a day of looking at the clouds and thinking, now what do I do today? That Jesus had good days and bad days, and he had taxes to pay, and he had to deal with famine and floods and neighbors and dogs that do doggy stuff and children who listen about as well as the cats.
Amen.
Amen. Jesus was a man who walked and lived among his countrymen. That's the claim that Paul makes. But Paul had just previously said that Jesus was God. So if Jesus is God and Jesus is one of us, what does that mean to us? That Jesus is God among us. All of this points to that fact that Jesus is God and God is with us. Wow. I mean, come on, folks. When you're walking down the street and you're looking around at your brothers or sisters or those neighbors, or you're watching the evening news and you're seeing this or that politician doing something that ticks you off again, think about where God is in that moment. Is God present or not? If God is not present, then, well, we're kind of wasting our time this morning. If God is present, then what? What are we doing? Talk about Jesus coming back. Well, Jesus never left. But God never left. Oh. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. So Paul is now lifting up in a bold way that aspect of faith called humility. Now, we don't talk about much humility in our day and age. I mean, to be humble means to be weak. To be weak means to be less of a man, or less of an American, or less whatever else you want to be less of. Paul is making a claim about God, that God did not send Jesus to dominate us, but to show us as humans, in our weakness lies our strength. That Jesus could have come down with fiery chariots and legions of angels and made bold, audacious claims upon us. But rather, he showed us a God who takes actions in the quietness of our hearts and minds, that lives in an example of love through the gift of service. That's what they're doing Sunday mornings before most of us get here. The ladies and a few men who are in the kitchen setting up a fellowship time. They're not just putting out cookies. They're not just making coffee. They're serving God. Do you realize what that means? sitting down and you're eating some of Julie's lemon bars, or you're having some of Glenda's lemon dill bread. You're not, or Hazel, you were talking about apple cake. And the bake section. Trust me, what you purchased that day is nothing compared to what the person baking was doing. They were baking for God. You're buying the experience of being in God's presence. So when you're trying to decide between this or that loaf of bread, thinking, what would God like today? And what would I like to share with God? Because that's what religion is about, folks. It's about sharing the moment with God. Wow. Are you excited, as excited as I am? I like this. I hope you do too. So let's see, we have Jesus as God, Jesus as one of us, Jesus as obedient. What could be next? What happened after Jesus died?
He rose.
Hello?
He came back.
Did Jesus come back from the dead?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Well, see, with some excitement. Oh my gosh! Jesus rose from the dead!
Woo!
Yeah, come on!
Hallelujah.
This isn't something to whisper in the shower. This is something to get up on the rooftop and say, yeah. This is one of those woo-hoo moments of Christianity.
Woo-hoo!
Jesus' resurrection wasn't a magic act. It wasn't a myth. It wasn't something that was spread about just to make the disciples look good. The disciples didn't raise Jesus. The church didn't raise Jesus. Who rose Jesus?
God.
God. Who is God?
Jesus.
And the Spirit. By the resurrection, God demonstrated once and for all, God will not leave us alone. But God is alive. Oh, and by the way, Jesus, therefore God highly exalted him and gave him a name above all names, so that the name of Jesus, everyone on earth, on heaven, and under earth might bow. Is anyone left out? Is there anyone? Basically, you're given three choices. You can be in heaven, you can be on earth, or you can be in the other place. That's it. Those are the three options. Is there any place God is not? No. Is there any place Christ is not? No. Is there any life that can be lived apart from God?
No.
No. What is possible? God is possible.